latest and good, to some shade and fit you to your manhood. May the gods direct you to the best.
Amen. I thank thee.
Aye, we're back in Cymbeline's palace. Scene 5. Thus far, and so farewell.
Thanks, royal sir. My Amber has wrote that I from hence, and am sorry that I must report ye my master's enemy.
Our subject, sir, will not endure this yoke, and for ourself to show less sovereignty than they must needs appear unkinglike.
So, sir, I desire of you contact overland as Milford Haven. Madam, all joy befall you and your grace, and you.
My lords, you are appointed for that office, and the due of honor is no point omit. So, farewell, noble Lucius.
Your hand, my lord.
Receive it friendly, but from this time forth, I wear it as your enemy.
Sir, the evidence is yet to name the winner. Very well.
Leave not the worthy Lucius. Good, my lords, till he have crossed the Severn. Happiness?
Bye.
He goes hence frowning, but it is honors that we have given him cause.
'Tis all the better. Your valiant Britons have their wishes in it.
Lucius hath wrote already to the emperor how it goes here, and it fits us therefore ripely our chariots and our horsemen be in readiness. The powers that he already hath in Gallia will soon be drawn to head from whence he moves his war for Britain.
Just not sleepy business. Must he looked too speedily and strongly.
Our expectations that it would be thus hath made us forward. But my gentle queen, where is my daughter? She hath not appeared before the Roman, and nor to us hath tendered the duty of the day. She looks us like a thing more made of malice than of duty, and we have noted it, and called her forth and before her us, and she will have no slight in sufferance.
Royal sir, since the exile of Posthumus most retired, hath her life been the cure whereof my lord 'tis time must do. Beseech your majesty, forbear sharp speeches to her. She's a lady, so tender of rebukes that words are strokes, and strokes death to her.
Where is she, sir? How can her contempt be answered?
Please you, sir, her chambers are all locked, and there's no answer that will be given to the loud of noise we make.
My lord, when last I went to visit her, she prayed me to excuse her keeping close, or to constrain by her infirmity she should that duty leave unpaid to you, which daily she was bound to proffer. This she wished me to make known, but our great court made me to blame in memory.
Her doors locked? Oh, not seen of late? Grant, heavens, that which I prove false. Exeunt.
Son, I say follow the king.
That managers, Pisanio, her old servant, have not seen these 2 days.
Go look after, Pisanio, that thou standest so for Posthumus. He hath a drug of mine. I pray his absence. Proceed by swallowing that, for he believes it is a thing most precious. But for her, where she has gone haply, despair hath seized her, or winged with fervor of her love, she's flown to her desired Posthumus. Gone she is to death, or to dishonor, and my end can make good use of either. She being down, I have the placing of the British crown. How now, my son?
'Tis certain she has fled. Go in and cheer the king. He rages. None dare come about him.
All the better. May this night forestall him of the coming day.
I love and hate her, for she's fair and loyal, and hath all the courtly parts more exquisite than lady. Ladies, women, from every one the best she hath, and she of all compounded outsells them all. I love her therefore, but disdaining me and throwing favors on the low posthumous, slanders so her judgment. What else rare is choked, and in that point I will conclude to hate her, nay, indeed, to be revenged upon her, for when she fools shall... Who's here? What are you packing, sirrah? Come hither. Ah, you precious pander, villain, where is thy lady? In a word, or else thou art straightways with the fiends.
Oh, good my lord.
Where is the lady? Or by Jupiter, I will not ask again. Close villain, I'll have this secret from thy heart, or rip thy heart to find it. Is she with Posthumus, from whom so many ways of baseness can a dram be worth drawn?
Alas, my lord, how can she be with him? When she was missed, she is in Rome.
Where is he, sir? Come nearer, no further halting. Satisfy me home, what is become of her?
Oh, my worthy lord.
All worthy villain! Discover where thy mistress is at once. At the next word, no more of worthy lord. Speak, or thy silence on this instant, thy condemnation on thy death.
Then, sir, this paper is the history of my knowledge touching her flight.
Let's see it. I will pursue her, even to Augustus's throne.
Or this, or perish. She's far enough, and what he learns by this may prove his travel, not her danger. All right, to my lord, she's dead. O Imogen, safe mayest thou wander, safe return again.
Sirrah, is this letter true?
Sir, as I think.
It is Posthumus' hand, I know it. Sirrah, if thou wouldst not be a villain, but do me true service, undergo those employments wherein I should have cause to use thee with serious industry. That is, what villainy soeth I bid thee to do, to perform it directly and truly. I would think thee an honest man. Thou should neither want my means for thy relief, nor my voice for thy preferment.
Well, my good lord.
Wilt thou serve me? For since patiently and constantly thou hast stuck to the bare fortune of that beggar Posthumus, thou canst not, in course of gratitude, but be diligent follower of mine. Wilt thou serve me?
Sir, I will.
Give me thy hand. Here's my purse. Hast any of thy late master's garments in thy possession?
I have, my lord, at my lodging, the same suit he wore when he took leave of my lady and mistress.
The first service thou dost me, fetch that suit hither. Let it be thy lint service. Go.
I shall, my lord.
Meet thee at Milford Haven. I forgot to ask him once one thing. I'll remember it anon. Even there, thou villain Posthumus, I will kill thee. I would these garments were come. She said upon a time, the bitterness of it I shall now belch from my heart, that she held the very garment posthumus in more respect than my noble and natural person together with the adornment of my qualities. With that suit upon my back, I'll ravish her. I'll kill him, and in her eyes there shall see my valor, which will then be a torment to her contempt. He, on the ground, my speech of insultment ended on his dead body. And when, excuse, when my lust hath dined, which I say to vex her, I will execute in the clothes that she so praised. To the court I'll knock her back, foot her home again. She hath despised me rejoicingly, and I'll be merry in my revenge. Be those the garments?
Aye, my noble lord.
How long is this she since went to Milford Haven?
She can scarce be there yet.
Bring this apparel to my chamber. That is the second thing I have commanded thee. The third is that thou wilt be a voluntary mute to my design. Be but duteous, a true preferment shall tender itself to thee. My revenge is now at Milford. Would I had wings to follow it. Come and be true.
Thou biddest me to my loss, for true to thee were to prove false, which I will never be to him that is most true. To Milford go, and find not her whom thou pursuest. Flow, flow, you heavenly blessings on her. This fool's speed be crushed with slowness. Labor be his speed.
Scene six. Imogen.
I see a man's life, hideous one. I have tired myself, and for two nights together have made the ground my bed. I should be sick, but that my resolution helps me. Milford, when the mountain top Pisanio showed thee, thou wast within a ken. O Jove, I think foundations fly the wretched, such I mean where they should be relieved. Two beggars told me I could not miss my way. Will poor folks lie that have afflictions on them, knowing 'tis a punishment or trial? Yes, no wonder, when rich ones scarce tell true. To lapse in fullness is sorer than to lie for need, and falsehood is worse in kings than beggars. My dear lord, thou art one to the false ones. Now I think on thee, my hunger's gone, but even before I was a point to sink for food. But what is this? Here is a path to it, to some savage hold. I were best not call, I dare not call. Yet famine, ere clean it overthrow nature, makes it valiant. Plenty and peace breeds cowards. Hardness ever of hardiness is mother. Ho, who's here? If anything that's civil, speak. If savage, take or lend. Ho! No answer? Then I'll enter. Best draw my sword, and if mine enemy but fear the sword like me, he'll scarcely look on it. Such a foe.
You, Polydor, have proved best woodman and a master of the feast. Cadwal and I will play the cook and servant. It's our match. The sweat of industry would dry and die. But for the end, it works too. Would die and die, but for the end, it works too. Come, our stomachs will make what's homely savory. Weariness can snore upon the flint when rusty sloth finds the down pillow hard. Now, peace be here, poor house that keeps thyself.
I am thoroughly weary.
I am weak with toil, yet strong in appetite.
There is cold meat in the grate. I'll browse on that. Whilst we have killed the cook.
Stay, come not in. but that it eats our victuals, I should think here was a fairy.
What's the matter, sir?
By Jupiter, an angel, or if not an earthly paragon. Behold divineness, no older than a boy.
Good masters, harm me not. Before I entered here, I called and thought to have baked for bought what I could, what I have took. Good troth, I have stolen not, nor would not, though I had found gold strewed on the floor. Here's money for my meat. I would have left it in the board so soon as I had made my meal and parted with prayers for the provider.
Money? Youth? Money?
Gold and silver rather turn to dirt, as 'tis no better reckoned. But of those who worship dirty gods...
I see you're angry. Know if you kill me for my fault, I should have died had I not made it.
Whither bound?
To Milford Haven.
What's your name?
Fideli, sir. I have a kinsman who is bound for Italy. He embarks at Milford, to whom being going almost spent with hunger, I'm fain in this offense.
Prithee, fair youth, think us no churls, nor measure our good minds by this rude place we live in. Well encountered is almost night. You shall have better cheer ere you depart, and thanks to stay and eat it. Boys, bid him welcome.
Were you a woman, youth, I should have one hard but be your groom. In honesty, I'd bid for you as I do buy.
I'll make it my comfort. He is a man. I'll love him as my brother, and such a welcome as I'd give to him after long absence, such as yours. Most welcome. Be sprightly, for you fall monk's friends.
Monk's friends? If brothers, would it have been so that they had been my father's so sons, then had my prize been less, and to more equal ballasting to thee, posthumous.
He rings at some distress.
Would I could free it.
Or I, where it be, what pain it cost, what danger, gods!
Mark, boys!
Great men, that had a court no bigger than this cave, did attend themselves and had the virtue which their own conscience sealed them, laying by that nothing, gift of differing multitudes, could not outpeer these twain. Pardon me, gods! I change my sex to be companion with them, since Leonatus falls.
It shall be so. Boys, we'll go dress our hunt. Fair youth, come in. Discourse is heavy, fasting. When we have supped, we'll mannerly demand thee of thy story, so far as thou wilt speak it.
Pray, draw near.
The night to the owl, and morn to the lark, less welcome.
Thanks, sir.
I pray, draw near.
And we'll skip the next scene, which is the first senator and the first tribune and whoever else. And we'll go on to Act 4. Mr. Cloten.
I am near to the place where they should meet. If Pisanio have mapped it truly, how fit his garments serve me? Why should this his mistress, who was made by him that made the tailor, not be fit too? The rather saving reverence of the word, for 'tis said a woman's fitness comes by fits, wherein I must play the workman. I dare speak it to myself, for it is not vainglory for a man and his glass to confer in his own chamber. I mean, the lines of my body are as well drawn as his, no less young, more strong. Not beneath him in fortunes, beyond him in advantage of the time, above him in birth, alike conversant in general services, and more remarkable in single oppositions. Yet this imperceiverant thing loves him in my despite. What mortality is! posthumous thy head, which now is growing upon thy shoulders, shall within this hour be off. Thy mistress enforced, thy garments cut to pieces before thy face, and all this done, spurn her home to her father, who may haply be a little angry for my so rough usage. But my mother, having power of his testiness, shall turn all into my commandments. My horse is tied up, safe, out, sword, and to a sore purpose. Fortune, put them in my hand. This is the very description of their meeting place, and their fellow dares not deceive me.
All right. Before we go on to scene two, Ruby, I think the queen has died.
I think so.
And I was wondering if you would want to read Caius Lucius, and that way Peter can read the others.
Sure.
Is that good?
Sure.
Put on your manly voice.
All right.
Here we go. Scene two.
You're not well. Remain here in the cave. We'll come to you after hunting.
Brother, stay here. Are we not brothers?
So man and man should be, but clay and clay differs in dignity. Whose dust is both alike? I am very sick.
Go you to hunting. I'll abide with him.
So sick I'm not, yet I am not well. But not so citizen a wanton as to seem to die ere sick. So please you, leave me. Stick to your journal course. The breach of custom is breach of all. I am ill, but your being by me cannot attend me. Society is no comfort to one not sociable. I am not very sick, since I can reason of it. Pray you, trust me here. I'll rob none but myself, and let me die stealing so poorly.
No, I love thee. I have spoke it. How much the quantity, the weight as much as I do love my father.
What? How? How?
If it be sin to say so, I yoke me in my good brother's fault. I know not why I love this youth. And I have heard you say, love's reasons, without reason, the bier at the door, and a demand who tis shall die. I'll say, my father, not this youth.
A noble strain, a worthiness of nature, breed of greatness. Cowards, father, cowards, and base things, sire, base. Nature hath meal and bran, contempt and grace. I'm not their father. Yet who this should be doth miracle itself, love before me. 'Tis the ninth hour of the morn.
Brother, farewell.
I wish you sport.
Good health, so please you, sir.
These are kind creatures. Gods, what lies I have heard. Our courtiers say all savage, but at court. Experience, oh, thou disprovest report. The imperious seas breed monsters, for the dish pour tributary rivers as sweet fish. I am sick still, heart sick. Pisanio, I'll now taste of thy drug.
I could not stir him. He said he was gentle, but unfortunate. Dishonesty afflicted, but yet honest.
Thus did he answer me, yet said, hereafter, I might know more.
To the field, we'll leave you for this time. Go in and rest.
We'll not be long away.
Pray, be not sick, for you must be our housewife.
Well or ill, I am bound to you.
And shalt ever be. This youth, however distressed, appears he hath had good ancestors.
How angel-like he sings.
But his neat cookery He cuts our roots in characters and sauces our broths, as Juno had been sick, and he her dieter.
Nobly he yokes, a smiling with a sigh, as if the sigh was that it was, not for being such a smile, the smile mocking the sigh, that it would fly from so divine a temple to commix with winds that sailors rail at.
I do note that grief and patience, rooted in him both, mingle their spurs together.
Grow patience, and let the stinking elder, grief, untwine his perishing root with the increasing vine.
It is great morning. Come away. Who's there?
I cannot find those ruggedat gats. That villain hath mocked me. I am faint.
Those runagates? Means he not us? My partner know him. 'Tis cloak, son of the queen. I fear some ambush. I saw him not these many years, and yet I know to see. We are held as outlaws, hence.
He is but one. You and my brothers search what companies are near, and pray you away. Let me alone with him.
Soft, what are you that fly me thus? Some villain and mountaineers? I have heard of such. What slave art thou?
A thing more slavish than I ne'er have to answering a slave without a knock.
Thou art a robber, a lawbreaker, a villain. Yield thee, thief.
To who? To who? To thee? What art thou? Have not I an arm as big as thine, a heart as big? Thy words, I grant, are bigger, for I wear not my dagger in my mouth. Say what thou art, and away I shall yield to thee.
Thou villain base, knowest me not by my clothes?
Not for thy tailor, rascal. What does thy grandfather, he made those clothes, which it seems make thee?
Thou precious varlet, my tailor made them not.
Hence then, and thank the man who gave them thee. Thou art some fool. I am loath to beat thee.
Curious thief, hear but my name and tremble.
What's thy name?
Cloten, thou villain.
Cloten, thou double villain, be thy name. I cannot tremble at it, were it toad or adder or spider. I would it twere me sooner.
To thy further fear, nay, to thy mere confusion, thou shalt know I am son to the queen.
I am sorry for it, not seeming so worthy as thy birth.
Art not afraid?
Those I fear, the wise, at fools I laugh, not fear them.
Die the death. When I have slain thee with my proper hand, I'll follow those that even now fled hence, and on the gates of Ludtowns set your heads. Yield, rustic mountaineer.
No companies abroad?
None in the world. Did make mistake him, sure.
I cannot tell. Long is it since I saw him, but time hath nothing blurred those lines of favor which then he wore. The snatches in his voice and burst of speaking were as his. I am absolute, 'twas very Cloten.
In this place we left them, I wish my brother made good time with him. You say he is so fell.
Being scarce made up, I mean, to man, he had not apprehension of roaring terrors, for the effect of judgment is oft the cause of fear. But see, my brother.
Ah! Bowton was a fool. So empty purse, there was no more in it. But not Hercules could have knocked out his brains, for he had none. And yet I am doing this. The fool had borne my head as I do his.
What hast thou done?
I am perfect. What cut off one on Cloten's head, son to the queen, after his own report, who called me traitor, mountaineer, and swore that this whole single hand he'd take us in. Disgrace our heads where, thank the gods, they grow, and set them as to Ludstown.
We are all undone.
Why, thy father? Oh, what have we to lose but what he swore to take our lives? The law protects not us. Then why should we be tender to let an arrogant piece of flesh threat us, play judge and executioner altogether himself? And for he did fear the law. What company discover you abroad?
No single soul can we set eye on, but in all safe reason. He must have some attendants, though his humor was nothing but mutation. Aye, and that from one bad thing to worse. Not frenzy, not absolute madness could so far have raved to bring him here alone, although perhaps it may be heard at court that such as we cave here, hunt here, are outlaws, and in time may make some stronger head, the which he hearing, as it is like him, might break out and swear he'd fetch us in, yet 'tis not probable to come alone. Either he's so undertaking, or they so suffering, than on good ground we fear, if we do fear this body hath a tail more perilous than the head.
Let ordinance come as the gods foresay it. Howsoever, my brother hath done well.
I had no mind to hunt this day. The boy Fidel's sickness did make my way long forth.
Oh, with his own sword, which he did wave against my throat, I have ta'en his head from him. I'll throw it into the creek behind our brook and let it to the sea and tell the fishes he's the queen's son. Cloten, that's all I seek.
I fear we'll be revenged. Would Polydor, thou hadst not done it, though valor becomes thee well enough.
Would I had done it, so the revenge alone pursue me, Polydor. I love thee brotherly, but envy much thou hast robbed me of this deed. I would revenges that possible strength might meet, would seek us through and put us to our answer.
Well, 'tis done. We'll hunt no more today, nor seek for danger where there's no profit. I prithee, to our rock. You and Fidel play the cooks. I'll stay till hasty Polydor return and bring him to dinner presently.
Poor sick Fidel. I'll wearily to him to gain his color. I'll let a perish of such Cloten's blood and praise myself for charity.
Oh, thou goddess, thou divine nature, how thyself thou blazest in these two princely boys. They are as gentle as Zephyr, blowing below the violet, not wagging his sweet head, and yet as rough their royal blood and chafed as the rudest wind that by the top doth take the mountain pine and make him stoop to the vale. 'Tis a wonder that an invisible instinct should frame them to royalty unlearned, honor untaught, civility not seen from other valor, that wildly grows in them but yields a crop as if it had been sowed. Yet still strange what close being here to us portends, or what his death will bring us.
Oh, where's my brother? Where is my brother? I haven't sent Cloten's clock call down the stream to embassy his mother, his body's hostage for his return.
My ingenious instrument. Hark, Polydor, it sounds. But what occasion hath Cadwal now to give it motion? Hark.
Hark?
Hark. Who, Darius?
Ah, is he at home?
He went hence even now.
What does he mean? Since death of my dearest mother, it did not speak before. All solemn things should answer solemn accidents. The matter? Oh, triumphs for nothing and lamenting toys is jollity for apes and grief for boys. Is Cadwal mad?
Look, here he comes and brings the dire occasion in his arms of what we blame him for.
The bird is dead that we have made so much on. I'd rather have skipped from 16 years of age to 60, to have turned my leaping time into a crutch, than have seen this.
Oh, sweetest, fairest Lily, my mother wears her not the one half so well as when thou brewest thyself.
Oh, melancholy, whoever yet could sound thy bottom, find the ooze to show what coast thy sluggish care might easiest harbor in. Thou blessed thing, Jove knows what man thou mightst have made, but I, thou diest, the most rare boy of melancholy. How found you him?
Stark, as you see, thus smiling as some fly hid tickled slumber, not as death's dart, being laughed at, his right cheek reposing on a cushion.
Why, he besleeps if he be gone. He'll make his grave a bed. With female fairies will his tomb be haunted, and worms will not come to it.
With fairest flowers while summer lasts, I live here, Fidel. I'll sweeten thy sad grave. Thou shalt not lack of the flower that, like thy face, pale primrose, nor the azured hairball, like thy veins, no, nor like the leaf of elegantine, whom's not to slander, out-sweetened not thy breath. The Rodok wood, with charitable bill, oh, bill, sore shaming those rich left heirs that left their fathers lie without a monument. Bring thee all this, yea, and furred moss besides, when flowers are none, to winter's ground they corpse.
To the grave, prithee, have done, and do not play in witch-like words with those and with that which is so serious. Let us bury him and not protract with it admiration what is now due debt. to the grave.
Say, where shall lay him?
My good Europhile, our mother, yes.
Be it so. And let us, Polydor, though now our voices have got the mannish crack, sing him to the ground as once our mother used like notes and words, save that Europhile must be Fidel.
Cadwal, I cannot sing. I'll weep and word it with thee, for notes of sorrow out of tune are worse than priests and thanes that lie.
We'll speak it then.
Great griefs I see, medicine the less, for Cloten is quite forgot. He was a queen's son, boys, and though he came our enemy, remember, he was paid for that. Though mean and mighty, rotting together, have one dust. Yet reverence, that angel of the world, doth make distinction of place between high and low. Our foe is princely, and though you took his life as being our foe, yet Belarius is a prince.
Pray you, fetch him hither. Tersides' body is as good as Ajax's when neither are alive.
If you'll go fetch him, we'll say our song whilst. Brother, begin.
Nay, Caldwell, we must lay his head to the east. My father has a reason for it.
'Tis true.
Come on, then, and remove him.
So begin.
Fear no more the heat of the sun. Thank you.
your face. Murder in heaven. How? Tis gone. Piesiago. All curses.
Let's hold it for a second. We've got Imogen back in the house.
I lost my spot now.
Zanio.
I don't have a number on it either.
Well, go ahead.
Keep on reading until I find it. Keep on reading.
This is like line 312.
But I have no numbers in my book.
Oh, you don't have number. Okay.
No.
You and I. It's the next page, the top it's, of 1080.
It's a long speech after she first wakes up.
Yeah, really long. Yeah.
It's like, line.
It's like two-thirds of the way through.
Okay, I get it. Where are you now?
The very top. All curses.
Yes, sir, to Milford Haven. Is that the one?
All curses matted. 1089.
All curses. All yes. Curses matted, Hecuba. Give the Greeks and mine to boot. Be darted on thee. Thou conspired with thy irregulous devil, Cloten, has here cut off my lord. To write and read be henceforth treacherous. Damn Pisanio. Hath with his forged letters, damn Pisanio, from this most bravest vessel of the world, struck the main top. O Posthumus, alas, where is thy head? Where is that? I mean, where is that? Pisanio might have killed thee at the heart and left thy head on. How should this be, Pisanio? To see in Cloten malice and lucre in them hath laid this woe here. Oh, 'tis pregnant. The drug he gave me, which he said was precious and cordial to me, have I not found it murderous to be to the senses that confirms it? Oh, this is Pisanio's deed and Cloten's. Oh, give color to my pale cheek with thy blood, that we, the horrider, may seem to those which chance to find us. Oh, my lord, my lord.
Would you read captain?
Oh, yeah, the captain.
To the legions garrisoned in Gallia, after your will, have crossed the sea, attending you here at Milford Haven with your ships. They are all in readiness.
But what from Rome?
The Senate has stirred up the confiners and gentlemen of Italy, most willing spirits that promise noble service. And they come under the conduct of bold Iacomo, Siana's brother.
Oh, when expect you then?
With the next benefit of the wind.
Ah, his foreignness makes our hope fair. Command our present members to be mustered. Bid the captains look on it. Now, sir, what have you dreamed of late, this war's purpose?
Last night, the very gods showed me a vision. I fast and prayed for their intelligence. Thus I saw Jove's bird, the Roman eagle, winged from the sponge south to this part of the west. There vanished in the sunbeams which portends. Unless my sins abuse my divination, success to the Roman host.
Dream so often so, and never false. Stop. Oh, what trunk is here without a stop? This ruin speaks that sometime it was worthy holding. How? A page? Or dead? Sleeping on him? But dead rather, for nature doth abhor make the bed with the defunct or sleep upon the dead. Let's see the boy's face.
He's alive, my lord.
Oh, then he'll instruct us of this body. Young one, inform us of thy fortune, for it seems thy crave to be demanded. Who is this thou makest the bloody pillow? Or who is he, the otherwise than the low noble nature did, hath altered the good picture? What's thy interest in this sad wreck? How come it? Who is it? What art thou?
I am nothing. Or if not nothing to be were better, this was my master, a very valiant Briton and a good that here by mountaineers lies slain. And alas, there is no more such masters. I may wander from east to occident, cry out for service, try many, all good, serve truly, never find such another master.
Ah, lack, good youth. Thou movest who knowest, then thy complaining that thy master is bleeding. Say his name, a good friend.
Richard Duchamp. If I do lie and do not no harm by it, though the gods hear, I hope they'll pardon it. Say you, sir.
Thy name?
Fidel, sir.
Ah, thou dost approve thyself in this very same. Thy name well fits thy faith. Thy faith, thy name. We'll take thy chance with me. I will not say thou shalt be well mastered, but be sure, no less beloved. The Roman Emperor's letter sent by a consul to me should not sooner than thine own worth prefer thee. Go with me.
I'll follow, sir. But first, and please the gods, I'll hide my master from the flies, as deep as these poor pickaxes can dig. And when with wild wood leaves and weeds I had strewn his grave, and on it said a century of prayers, such as I can, twice o'er, I'll weep and sigh, and leaving so his service, follow you. So please you entertain me.
Aye, good youth, rather father thee than master thee. My friends, the boy hath taught us manly duties. Let us find the prettiest daisied plot we can, and make him with our pikes and the partisans a grave. Come, arm him. Boy, he's preferred by thee to us, and he shall be interred as soldiers can. Be cheerful, wipe thine eyes. Some falls are mean, the happier to arise.
All right, scene three, we'll skip. Cymbeline wonders where Imogen and Cloten have gone and questions Pisanio. Scene four, Belarius wants to flee the area, but his adopted sons are eager to fight the Romans. And then on to act five, Posthumus, having returned to Britain with the Romans, is devastated to learn from Pisanio of Imogen's death. He dresses as a peasant and resolves to fight for his country. Scene two, act five, takes us to Lucius, Iachimo, Imogen, all the others.
The heaviness and guilt within my bosom takes off my manhood. I have belied a lady, a princess of this country, and the air on it revengingly enfeebles me. Or could this Carl, a very drudge of nature's, have subdued me in my profession? Knighthoods and honor, born as I wear mine, are titles but scorn. If that the thy gentry, Britain, go before this lout, as he exceeds our lord, the odds is that we scarce are men, and you gods. The battle continues. Stand, we have the advantage of the crown. Elaine is guarded, nothing routs us but the villainy of our fears.
Stand back and fight. Posthumus, stand back. The seconds of the Britons, they rescues Cymbeline and all exit. Then enter Lucius, Iachimo, and Imogen.
Away, boy, from the troops, and save thyself from friends, kill friends, and disorders such as we were hoodwinked.
'Tis their fresh supplies.
It is the days turned strangely. Our betimes, let's reinforce or fly.
Scene three. Una is playing the Lord. Oh, Lord.
Canst thou from where thou mayest stand?
I did, though you didst seem to come from the flyers.
I did.
No blame to be to you, sir, for all was lost, but that the heavens fought the king himself. Of his wings destitute, the army broken, but the backs of Britons seen, all flying through a straight lane. The enemy, full-hearted, lolling their tongue, was slaughtering, having worked so plentiful the tools to do it, struck them, struck down, some mortally, some slightly touched, some falling merely through fear, and the straighter pass was the damned with dead men hurt behind, and cowards living to die with length of chain.
Where was this slain?
Oh, close by the battle, ditched and walled with the turf, which gave advantage to an ancient soldier, an honest one, I warrant, who deserved so long a breeding as his white head beard came to. In doing this for his country, athwart the lane, he, with two striplings, lads with more like to run the country base than to commit such slaughter, which faces were fit for mast and weather were fairer than those preservation case or shame, made good the passage, cried to those that fled, "Our Britons' hearts die flying, not our men to darkness fleet, souls that fly backwards. Stand, or we are Romans, and will give you that, like beasts, which you are short, shun beastly, and may save but to look back in town. Stand, stand." These 3,000 confidence in act as many, for three performers are defiled with all, the rest do nothing. And with this word, stand, stand, accommodated by the place, the mere charming of with their own nobleness, which could have turned the staff to a lance. Gilded pale looks, part shame, part spirit renewed, that some turned coward, but by example, oh, a sin and war damned in the first beginners, began to look the way that they did, and to grin like lions upon the piles of pikes of hunters. Then began a step to the chance, a retire, anon, a rout, confusion thick. Forthwith they fly, chickens, chickens, the way they atop the eagles, slaves, the strides they victors made, and now our cowards, like fragments of hard voyages, became the life of the need. Having found the back door open of the unguarded hearts, heavens, how they whelmed that sea shunned before. Some died, some their friends, or born the former wave. 10 chased by one, and now each the slaughter man of 20. Those that would die or resist are grown the mortal bugs in the field.
This was strange chance, a narrow lane, an old man, and two boys.
Nay, do not wonder at it. You are made rather to wonder at the things you hear than to work any. Will you rhyme upon it and vent it for a mockery? Here is one. Two boys, an old man, twice a boy, a lane, preserved the Britons, was the Romans' bane.
Nay, be not angry, sir.
Back to what end? Who dares not to stand his foe? I'll be his friend, for if he'll do as he is made to do, I know he'll quickly fly my friendship too. You have put me into rhyme.
Farewell, you're angry.
And we'll skip the rest of that scene.
Okay, good.
Scene 4 has more in the prison that he is locked away, and it's a special vision that he sees. That would be, he awakes from a vision to see a written prophecy that both his and Britain's miseries will end. So from that, we go on to scene 5 in Cymbeline's tent. And my crown is missing. Oh, there it is. Okay.